This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truths in Jesus Christ's name.
Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to another broadcast on Hour of the Truth. Today we have the 10th of September, 2015, Thursday, as usual. And together with me as co-host tonight is, as usual, my good friend and brother in Christ in Oregon on the west coast of the United States of America, as I like to call it, Walt Stickle from Grand Design Exposed. But before you will hear from him, you first have to deal with my voice a little bit, because there are some things that I want to introduce to you. This is called the Catholic Conquest of America, the United States of America, to be exactly. And I will do a reading of that, and it is actually in 10 parts. So today we're going to hear the first part of that. And I think this is a very nice introduction into also when we later go into the reading back on the Jesuit or the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy booklet that Walt Stickle put together, where we have left off last time reading an excerpt of chapter 31 from P.D. Stewart's book Code Word Babylon, Danger in the Vatican. And we are reading still in the in the Revolutionary War, how America became a Jesuit enclave. But that will probably be for part two or the later part of part one of this broadcast, meaning the first 45 minutes or the second 45 minutes. So first of all, everybody welcome. Also those who are listening live, always appreciated to have a live audience. And everybody welcome who will later on watch the video. And remember, I always do my homework and put the links that are important for these broadcasts in the description box of the video. So I appreciate it when you start doing your own research, not taking for granted everything that I or Walt say here, but do your own research, and the links that I provide to you in that box, of course, can help you. And therefore, I would appreciate it if you did that also. But first of all, I will start with reading a little part of this, The Catholic Conquest of America, Part 1. And I start with a quote from Bishop Ireland, Baltimore Catholic Catholic Council from 1890. Quote, "Our work is to make America Catholic, and our hearts shall leap toward it with crusader enthusiasm." End quote. And now follows a very interesting quote that comes from the, what's it called, Encyclopedia Britannica, volume 14, under the article of Plato in page 531. Now you're going to ask yourself, what does Plato have to do with it? Well, Plato is as much anti-biblical as the Pope is. And there they have something very much in common, and you will see that within a few moments. The quote from Encyclopedia Britannica reads as follows. Plato was, with Socrates and Aristotle, one of the three philosophers of ancient Greece, who between them laid the philosophical foundations of Western culture. Unquote. If we consult most reference, if we consult most reference works, such as the one above mentioned from the Encyclopedia Britannica, about the famous Greek philosophers Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, they invariably state that these three individuals are the founders of Western civilization. All three of them lived in Athens when Athens was a functioning democracy, but not one of them was a supporter of democracy. Socrates was condemned to death for, quote-unquote, corrupting the youth of Athens. We do not know exactly what Socrates taught the youth of Athens, because he wrote nothing down, but we do have the writings of Plato, who was Socrates' disciple. And if the writings of Plato reflect the teachings of his master, Socrates, then it is clear that Socrates was not teaching the youth of Athens to support and uphold democracy. In fact, there is nothing democratic in the philosophy of the so-called fathers of Western civilization. Indeed, it would not be exaggerating to call them the original Nazis. Now, I want to turn your attention here to the Bible. And open up your Bible in the book of Revelation, chapter 13. And we read in verse 2, "And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority." Unquote. Now you're going to ask yourself, is he gone crazy? What does that have to do with Greece? What does that have to do with Plato, Socrates, and Aristotle? Well, I tell you, the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard. And if you have read the prophecies of Daniel, then it is dealing with four different beasts. The first beast was a lion with wings, and that was Babylon. And the second beast was like a bear, you know, with the three ribs in his mouth. And this beast has the feet of a bear. And this beast has the mouth of a lion. And it was unto a leopard. And the leopard is, in Daniel's prophecy, the Grecian Empire at that time. And now, I want to turn your attention to a video made by a brother in Christ called Forerunner 777. Forerunner 777. The video is called Leopard Vision, Volume 1. And I will attach the link of this video into the description box of the video. And then you can see how the Roman Catholic Church bases all her teachings on the so-called fathers of Western civilization. And one of the earliest references on that are the teachings of Thomas Aquinas, who lived in the 13th century and is until today seen as one of the greatest philosophers the Roman Catholic Church ever had. And therefore, it is very vital to understand why this beast was like unto a leopard. A leopard is a carnivore, and a leopard never changes its spots. The Roman Catholic Church is a carnivore because it feeds on the souls of Christians. And it is also never changing. Rome never changes, and the leopard never changes its spot also. So when you watch this video, The Leopard Vision, Volume 1 from Forerunner 77, I have to go into a few quotes that I posted as a comment on that video. And the first quote comes from Archbishop Quigley in the Chicago Tribune of 1903. Quote, "When the United States rules the world, the Catholic Church will rule the world." End quote. And another quote that comes from Father Charles Chiniquy. Well, maybe I should not call him Father because he, at the end of his life, of course, turned to Christ. But he was, for more than 25 years, a priest in the Roman Catholic Church, and he wrote a book, 50 Years in the Church of Rome. And when you turn to page 373, you will read the following quote. "We, meaning the Catholic Church, are determined to take possession of the United States and rule them. But we cannot do that without acting secretly and with utmost wisdom. If our plans become known, they will surely be defeated." End quote. And when we turn two pages further, on page 375, we read the following. Quote, "Rome is in constant conspiracy against the rights and liberties of man all over the world, but she is particularly so in the United States. Long before I was ordained a priest, I knew that my church was the most implacable enemy of this republic. My professors of philosophy, history, and theology have been anonymous in telling me that the principles and laws of the Church of Rome were absolutely antagonistic to the laws and principles that are the foundation stones of the Constitution of the United States." Unquote. Now, when you pay a little bit attention, you will ask yourself, the professor that taught Charles Chiniquy, one of the professors, was a professor of philosophy. What in a name has philosophy to do with the teachings of Christ and the teachings of the Bible, I ask you? And when you go a little bit into that, you can answer that for yourself. I don't have to answer that for you. But as I said, do your own research. Remember, Thomas Aquinas, and now this quote from Charles Chiniquy. And I will end this comment that I made on the video with another quote from page 374 of the same book, 50 Years in the Church of Rome. And that reads as follows. Quote, "The American people must be very blind indeed if they do not see that if they do nothing to prevent it, the day is very near when the Jesuits will rule their country from the magnificent White House at Washington to the humblest civil and military department of this vast republic." Unquote. Now I turn back to my reading of the Catholic Conquest of America. You remember we left off when I told you to make the connection to Revelation 13, verse 2, the beast like unto a leopard. For the sake of brevity, it is easier to quote a scholar of Greek philosophy than to quote the philosophers themselves. The following is a good summary of Socratic Platonic philosophy. And just to remind you, I'm sorry, my mind is dwelling always when I read things like this. When you want to know more about Plato, I did a broadcast during the time of Nothing But the Truth, and that is uploaded in the playlist on my YouTube channel, Juggler66, in the playlist Nothing But the Truth, Plato's Cave. And I really advise you to have a look at that. Very interesting. But okay. The following is a good summary of Socratic and Platonic philosophy. Quote, "I believe that Plato's political program, far from being morally superior to totalitarianism, and that includes fascism, Nazism, and communism, and remember who founded fascism, Nazism, and communism, is fundamentally identical with it. And this quote comes from Leonard Verdun, The Antinomy of a Hybrid, the Christian Hymnary Publishers, page 87. An analysis of Plato's writings reveals that he believed in a rigidly stratified society with a hierarchy of three classes: the philosopher kings at the top, the military to defend and keep order, and the workers whose function was to provide for the needs of the rulers and the military. Does that sound any familiar when you have a look at the United States of today? Plato condemned the notion of individuality and freedom of conscience. I think that Plato has very much in common with the current Antichrist, Pope Francis. When I read that Plato condemned, I could also read Francis condemned the notion of individuality and freedom of conscience. According to Plato, the welfare of society as a whole was the first and primary goal. Aristotle taught the same. He was Plato's disciple, remember? Therefore, all freedom of expression and individual rights had to be subordinated to, quote-unquote, the common good, an expression that is very current today, along with its cousin, political correctness. But it gets worse. Not only was everything and everyone governed by the dogma of common good, all deviation from the norm had to be suppressed and punished. Plato actually insisted that all dissent had to be punished with death. Ring a bell in comparison to the Roman Catholic Church? This philosophy was to function at all levels and in every sector of society. Not only was everyone to do the same thing, they also had to believe the same thing. The goal was uniformity. Everyone the same, thinking, believing the same things, especially when it came to religion. We can call this system sacralism. Well, you can also call it communism, because these rigid rules were considered sacred, or as the Roman Catholic Church likes to call it, even holy. They were so sacred that anyone who tried to live differently was considered a threat to the common good and a traitor to the community, and any such person who dared to express opinions or act contrary to that sacred system was labeled a heretic, or, as today, labeled a biblical fundamentalist or a terrorist, as you probably heard in the beginning of the song that played in the beginning of this show. By the way, the word heretic comes from the Greek word herein, which means to stand before alternatives and make a choice between them. The freedom of making a choice, the freedom of conscience. The freedom of conscience is being heretic, because only the Pope can be the master of your conscience. That's what the Roman Catholic hierarchy teaches. In a sacral society, there are no choices to be made. It should be obvious to most that this kind of society advocated by Plato is totally alien and incompatible with the philosophy and ideals of the United States of America, as enshrined in the U.S. Constitution, the Bill of Rights, etc. But what most people do not realize is that the United States of America, historically, is a relative newcomer on the worldwide stage. Prior to the American Revolution and the establishing of an independent nation state called the United States of America, all nations were sacral societies, or holy, following the philosophy of the Greek philosophers, especially Plato. They are, after all, called the fathers of Western civilization. But they are not the fathers of the philosophy which governed the foundation of America. The political, social, and religious foundational principles undergirding the United States of America came from an entirely different source. The United States of America was and still is a unique creation, never seen before in history of the world. It is not of the sacral totalitarian tradition of Plato, and it is based on principles that are directly in opposition to the Platonic tradition. You can also say to the Catholic tradition. This made it a great threat to the ancient regimes, those that still lived under the Platonic or Catholic model. Therefore, the creation of America was a direct challenge to the powers that be on the other side of the Atlantic. And that challenge was felt nowhere more severely than in Rome by the Roman Catholic Church. And this ends my reading of this Signs of the Times article, The Catholic Conquest of America, Part 1, for today. And I think that even putting this video from the Forerunner in there and this few quotations that I got from my own comment that I wrote in there, I think that was a very nice way to start our broadcast today. And I'm interested if Walt, next to the things that he has prepared to say now in the first part of our show, maybe has even something to reflect on things that I've just said. Anyway, Walt, welcome to the broadcast, and please share your thoughts with us.
Well, good evening, Belgium, from the United States. Well, yes, I want to comment right off what you were talking about, freedom of conscience. You see, freedom of conscience is something that a lot of people don't understand. They preach about it and talk about it. They don't understand. You see, that enables me to disagree with you. See, and there's a lot of little popes out here. These evangelical ministers, when you go into these churches, do not allow you freedom of conscience. They become,
like Kenneth Copeland and Billy Graham and Benny Hinn and all these evangelical people, you mean, huh?
They do not allow you freedom of conscience. I mean, in other words, it's like I use a quick example, is the Sabbath. The earth was created in 6 days, and God rested on the seventh. And the seventh day is Saturday.
That is what it all comes down to in the future, Walt.
Well,
sorry to interrupt you here, but I think this is important to state for our listeners. The Sabbath is the mark that Bible-believing Christians have, opposite to the mark that the people will have that submit to the dragon or antichrist system. The church, the Roman Catholic Church itself, states that transferring the Sabbath from the seventh day of the week to the first day of the week is a mark of their authority. And when you have another mark, because you don't believe in the authority of man, but in the authority of God Almighty, then you are a heretic. And according to their Platonic views, you can be disposed of. But please continue, Walt. Sorry, but I think I had to interrupt you and make that little point.
Well, that's true, and I'm not disagreeing with anything you said, you see. But when somebody, when somebody like Billy Graham or, in other words, I don't attack somebody for keeping Sunday as their Sabbath. I have freedom of conscience. They have freedom of conscience. And if they have read the Bible and come to that conclusion, you have to allow freedom of conscience. You see, but the Roman Catholic Church does not allow freedom of conscience. the leopard does not, the spots on the leopard do not change. You know, so see, somebody can disagree. See, people are allowed to disagree. You know, but when somebody attacks me, because about the Sabbath, they have that right, and I have my right. And my right is freedom of conscience. I have to give that to them. You know, because I'm going to tell you the word that I want to talk about today, this morning, before we continue with our how America became a Jesuit enclave, is the word Protestant, Protestantism. You know, first of all, I'd like to read what J.A. Wiley says about Protestantism. Listen to carefully to what J.A. Wiley, and I think J.A. Wiley is well qualified. He wrote a four volumes on the history of Protestantism. So what is J.A. Wiley's quote? He says, Protestantism is a principle which has its origin outside of human society. It is a divine craft on the intellectual and moral nature of man, whereby new vitalities and forces are introduced into it, and the human stem yields henceforth a more noble fruit. It is the descent of a heaven-born influence which allies itself with all the instincts and powers of the individual, permitting the highest development of which humanity is capable. And then I'd like to have you, York, give another quote from J.A. Wiley.
Yeah, I'm glad to. I just posted it on Skype that you can read it for yourself, but I'm glad to quote that myself. J.A. Wiley stated in two little sentences everything that Walt just summed up. In a word, Protestantism is a revived Christianity after the adoption by the pagan Roman Empire, unquote. And I think these two little sentences sum it absolutely up. Protestantism is revived Christianity because Christianity sold out, not by its own choice, but by the choice of Emperor Constantine in 321, when Constantine so-called turned Christian and baptized everything that was dear to Christianity, the saints and everything with it. And one of the best examples of that is when you go, and you don't have to go there personally, you can do that via Google probably, and you can do that via pictures that you can see when you go to the Vatican, and you will see in St. Peter's Basilica the statue of Peter, which is actually a statue they took from Greece, and that represents Jupiter. And they baptized Jupiter to be Peter. And this is only one of hundreds of examples how they did that. So, again, in a word, Protestantism is revived Christianity after the adoption by the pagan Roman Empire. Now, back to you, Walt.
And now, a Protestant. Now, what are they protesting? It's a protest, you know, against Rome. Now, where in that definition did he talk about, J.A. Wiley talk about Rome? If you read that again, what he says, like Protestantism is a principle which has its origin outside of human society. Outside of human society. Everything that J.A. Wiley is saying here is the opposite to Rome.
Then it must come out of God's society, right? If it's not of the human society.
That's right. And he says it is a divine craft on the intellect, a divine craft on the intellectual and moral nature of man. Again, it's the complete opposite of Rome. And I'm going to finish the last sentence because it's all the way through he says it, but he says, it is the descent of a heaven-born influence which allies itself with all its instincts and powers of the individual, permitting the highest development in which humanity is capable. It is the descent of a heaven-born influence. It's just the opposite of Rome. Rome comes from man's authority. And Protestantism comes from a heavenly wisdom. So man can, highest development of which humanity is capable. Now you understand the glimmer of light of the Protestant Reformation and how it exploded. And now we can come to the Pope's visit, a Jesuit Pope, a counter-Reformation Pope, because you can always replace the word Jesuit with counter-Reformation.
The reason of their founding.
That's their founding.
When you read or follow my reading of Rulers of Evil, I think it was in chapter 7, where I went into that, what did Pope Paul III, was it, in 1540, cry out when Ignatius of Loyola presented to him the oath of induction, the fourth vow of the Jesuits? Hoc est digitus Dei. This is the fingerstroke of God. The question is, which God? What did he refer to? But please continue, Walt.
Well, now that we get a, because the truth of it is, now the truth, the reality of this, is when I first started opening my eyes to Rome, you know, I started looking into the definition of a Protestant. And I found it when I went out into the public and asked the question that people did not know the answer. And the truth of it, the reality of this, this is where we live today. We live in a culture that doesn't know the definition of a Protestant. I declared my Protestantism over a luncheon I had here about a week. You know, and I realized after I'd said it that people really don't realize what I was declaring, because it's been swept out of our minds. So that's why this chapter by P.D. Stewart, How America Became a Jesuit Enclave, is so important, because this is a hard pill for a lot of people, but the ecumenical movement started in 1776. The evangelical movement started with the Declaration of Independence. And the destruction of America did not come from the government. The state of we're in today came from the pulpit. The pulpit was infiltrated and completely destroyed and swept out of the mind of the masses of America and the world, because it's no different in Europe, where the Protestant Reformation was born in Germany. They're taking Luther down, his name off of streets. It is a complete turnaround, and they did it through education. They didn't do it with guns. They went into the seminaries. They went into the Bible colleges and they taught futurism. It didn't take hold all at once, but today it's an abomination. And they teach the 69th week. And when they do that, they're denying Christ's ministry. They're doing the same things the Jews did when Christ came the first time. Futurism is a denial of the gospel. A complete denial. It's an abomination. Now, I am not judging any man. I'm not naming any names. But what I just stated is very, very important. And if you don't know what futurism is, you know, this is what this broadcast is for, is to teach people how to get the information and point them in the right direction so they can connect the dots themselves. And the audience on this call, I'm concerned mainly with the people that have had their eyes open, because this comes out of Michael D. Semblin. He says, and I said this last week, but this is so important because I'm interested. Once you understand what I just said, what are you going to do with this information? See, the author recognizes that for all the weight of evidence, all the lessons of history, all the testimony of great men, the reader will not fully recognize the role of Rome, nor the roads which lead to her, unless God in his grace quickens the understanding through his word. Now, you know, I'm going to ask a little question to you, York. First of all, I'm going to tell you what it's done to me. We study history. We study names and dates. We put things in the right order. And we acknowledge history. We acknowledge the Reformation. We acknowledge that there was a counter-Reformation. But what does this do to my behavior? How I conduct myself with my fellow brother in Christ, or when I leave the door here today and go downtown. I'll tell you what it's done to my heart. It's humbled me. There are too many people that think if we just study the names and the dates and the issues of this, with not understanding the full implement of the gospel and the simplicity of the gospel. And I read it last, Henry Grattan Guinness's presenting the gospel, and it's in the inner flap of, and it's right on my homepage. The gospel is delivered in a paragraph using over 24, 25 Bible passages. He delivers the gospel. What it's done to me is this. I have the liberty in Christ. That's in Galatians. The only freedom that we have is in Christ. It's not in this world. It is not in this world. And I'll tell you, it has given me more patience. when I see all the movements out here, all the organizations that kind of preach dominion theology, we're not going to straighten this out. There's going to be a new world order. It is written. And we are seeing the formation right in our time. You couldn't have said that if you were living in 1870. The Pope could have never come to America in 1870. In 1890. You see, futurism is Roman Catholicism. When you hear evangelicals, and boy, they will not give you your freedom of conscience, you walk into any of these evangelical Roman Catholic churches, and they will not give you freedom of conscience, because they are preaching Francisco Vibera Futurism, a book that he wrote, 500 pages. Now, when he first wrote the book in 1590, he was teaching to the Catholics. When you understand the implications and how it was applied, it didn't happen overnight. You had Darby, you had the Schofield Bible. And how did they take over America? We are living in post-America. How can you say that, Walt? Well, in a couple of weeks, we have a counter-reformation pope openly speaking to a joint session of Congress with the House chaplain, a counter-reformation chaplain. We might be, this is no different than in Jeremiah's time. But the reason for this broadcast today is to cover P.D. Stewart's, the 31st chapter, out of Code Word Babylon, how America became a Jesuit enclave. And I think it's very appropriate at the time, I mean, to understand that the American Revolution was about religion, wasn't about tea and taxes. The founders of this country were not Christians. They were out of the Enlightenment, Voltairism. They studied under Voltairism.
Let me add here a little thing, please. I just listened today to an interview Tom Friss did some years ago with Chris Pinto. That was quite short after Chris Pinto published his documentary, The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. I will upload that audio within a few days on my YouTube channel, Juggler66, because this goes in the same direction that my last reading of Rulers of Evil, chapter 16, went also. Explaining that every time when you hear somebody, and I will not know the name because you all know who I'm referring to, teaching that George Washington was a Baptist Calvinist and a Christian, you will see, hear, and listen, and can do your research of your own, that is a blatant lie. And this interview, almost an hour long, where Tom Friss interviews Chris Pinto, is very, very interesting. He didn't only do the documentary, The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers, he also did the documentary, A Light in the Dark, or A Candle in the Dark, what's it called?
A Lamp in the Dark.
A Lamp in the Dark, yeah, sorry, A Lamp in the Dark. This is one of the videos I put into my playlist on my YouTube channel, Dr. 66, called My Path to Christianity. When you see that lamp in the dark and the second part of it, the tares among the wheat, which is part two of that documentary, and then you combine it with the hidden faith of the founding fathers, so many things will all of a sudden come clear to your mind and you will have a much better understanding. And that interview that Tom Press did with Chris Pinto is wonderfully, and I don't want you to miss that. So it's not uploaded yet. It will take a few days, but please keep an eye on my channel. And when I upload it, don't miss that, because that is a very, very important one-hour interview where he goes into the depths of what Walt just said here and also of what I read from the Science of the Times. What was it called? The Catholic Conquest of America. It all goes hand in hand. The Catholic Conquest of America from Signs of the Times, the reading of Rulers of Evil, Chapter 16, the interview Tom Press did with Chris Pinto, the documentary The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers, and, of course, that what we will do in a moment, the reading of the Revolutionary War, how America became a Jesuit enclave. It all fits in together. And the more pieces we give you, and this is the difference between us and the teaching outside of us in the mainstream, the more pieces we will give you, the more knowledge you can gain on that real history based on the Bible, instead of being always led into from one dead road into another dead road. We will give you the possibility, when you put these puzzles together, to see in the end the whole picture. And then there's only the question remaining for you, dear listener. Every one of you personally, what do I believe? Do I believe the teaching of God that makes sense? Or do I believe the teaching of man that does not make that much sense? And whether you turn to the Bible or whether you turn to men, that is up to you. As Walt said, that is your freedom of conscience. We cannot interfere with that. Everybody has to make that decision for himself. But you are given the chance in this lifetime to see that this 50, 60, 70, 100 years, whatever, that you spend on this earth, are the only time that you will be living? Or will you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Understand that he, 2,000 years ago, was nailed to the cross for your sins to open the small gate to heaven that you can receive eternal life. Would you rather have this few years given on the earth in this system to be the only life that you have? Or will you rather choose eternal life together with your father and brother, Jesus Christ? That is up to you. What Walt is doing here on the show and what I am doing here on the show is we are trying to show you the way to the door that leads to eternal life. And when you disagree, and when you say, not for me, I don't care, hey, that's your decision. Christ never once, when he walked the earth, advocated physical force. Never. That is one very point where Christ is distinguished from the so-called vicar of Christ, who has used nothing else than force and bloodshed, whether, he says, you adhere to my teaching or I will kill you. And Jesus Christ said, whether you listen to my teaching or you will pay the price for not. But it is your choice. Jesus is the one that gives you a choice. Rome is the one that does not give you a choice. But please, Walt, continue if something more to say.
No, except it's a very important message. If you go to Grand Design Exposed, you can get a download copy of it. It's on button 33 called Untold History. And Tom Fress interviewed Christian Pinto on December 8, 2010.
Yeah, that's the one.
And it's, I would go into it a little bit, except you'll understand the declaration of indulgence versus the you'll see how the relationship between the Declaration of Independence in 1688 and the Declaration of Independence in 1776, you'll see the comparison where one failed in 1688, the one in 1776 was successful. And so I'll just leave you with that. It'll give you a little bit of an interest to go click on the interview and listen to it, because I've listened to Chris Pinto, and because it's very instrumental in what we're going to be talking about with this chapter 31 and how America became a Jesuit enclave. So that's all mm-hmm. I got to say.
Oh, absolutely. And I know that you can listen to on your website on that, because I downloaded the audio from there. But I'm going to make a video out of it, because a lot of people also follow my YouTube channel. And I think it is very interesting to put this interview that Tom Fress did with Chris Pinto in 2010, to put it into a video.
Yes, it have it in another place. It's something that won't go away.
Exactly. Yeah. The more exposure the truth gets, the more certain it can be that more people can learn of it.
Yeah.
Okay, before I will start reading now from the Revolutionary War, how America became a Jesuit enclave, I just want to close this first part of the broadcast with an explanation that is given when you open Webster's Dictionary, 1828 edition, and you type in the word Protestant. I'm not going to read that only to make sure that you understand what a Protestant actually is or where the word derived from, but also you will probably understand why I no longer call myself a Protestant. So the explanation from Webster's Dictionary goes as follows. A Protestant is one of the party who adhered to Luther at the Reformation in 1529 and protested, or made a solemn declaration of dissent from a decree of the Emperor Charles V and the Diet of Spires, and appealed to a general council. This name was afterwards extended to the followers of Calvin, and Protestants is the denomination now given to all who belong to the Reformed churches. The King of Prussia has, however, interdicted the use of this name in his dominions. Now, why do I not call myself a Protestant anymore? Because I understand when I read the Bible and when I read this explanation of a Protestant, quote unquote, this name was afterwards extended to the followers of Calvin, and Protestants is the denomination now given to all who belong to the Reformed churches. I never in my life up to now, and I can tell you very surely this will be in the future the same thing, was never part of one of the denominations. And being part of this one of these denominations, whether it is Calvinism, whether it's Baptism, whether it's Methodist, whether it's Lutherans, or whatever name they call, There was a very interesting video with Kenneth Copeland some time ago where Bishop Tony Palmer said, the protest is over. And I went over this on other broadcasts on Hour of the Truth, and I made my own video on that. Look it up for yourself. The protest is not over, or whatever it's called. Look it up. You will find it on my channel. Putting the Protestants, the so-called Protestants, in so many different denominations is a sign of division. And Rome feeds on that division and says, now everybody has to come back under our wings, because all these denominations today do not believe what was taught initially. What was taught initially? That the Pope, the papacy, the hierarchy of the Roman Catholic Church is the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist. And as Walt already stated in this broadcast and another broadcast, that protest is virtually over today, because no one in these denominations today, and you can go to all of them and ask the pastor, who is the Antichrist? Oh, he's somewhere to come in the future, 7 years before Christ's return, and then we will see, and in 3.5 years, and he will end the sacrifices and the oblations as written in Daniel 9:27, where the he is, of course, Jesus Christ, who stopped that 2,000 years ago, and not some person in the future. All these denominations are wrong, and all these denominations have one or another link to the Roman Catholic Church. I do not call myself a Protestant anymore, because I am not intertwined with these denominations in no way. I call myself a witness of the truth. And the truth is written in a book, and it is called the 1611 Authorized Version of the King James Bible, the only preserved true Word of God in the English language that we have today in 2015. I am not a Protestant. I am a witness of the truth of the Word of God. And whether you follow me in that or you don't, hey, you have freedom of conscience. Make up your own mind.
Well, this is a good time for me to exercise my freedom of conscience. I am a Protestant. I am a Protestant. I believe just exactly like J.A. Wiley defined it, that I defined earlier.
Yeah, that's right.
So you know, but you have your right. But I'm starting to see, you see, the reason I read the definition of J.A. Wiley's talking about Protestantism, not only that, he wrote a book of 2,000 pages.
Yeah, you know, Walt, it's not that I don't call my Protestant that I'm not protesting.
Well,
don't
see,
intermingle these two. I am still protesting.
I understand. I understand, but in other words, I think it's I realize the world. See, we both realize, and it's just a historical fact that the word Protestantism, if you take the word and go out on the streets, that people don't know, but what the word really means. And it's not until lately that I realized, and like another thing that I realized, you know, yes, the Pope is the Antichrist, but it's much bigger than that.
Much bigger.
The Pope is the little horn in Daniel. He's the man of sin and the son of perdition in 2 Thessalonians.
The Pope is the man who will jump in as Christ on earth after put a fake Antichrist in the to build temple in Jerusalem, and the Jews start their sacrifices again.
Yeah.
And he will make an end of that. And the person that jumps in then as Christ is the Antichrist all along. As Jesus said, I have come in my Father's name, and you received me not. And someone else is coming in his own name, and him you will receive. That is the Pope of Rome.
And they've received him, and they've already received him. It's not in the future. They've done it already. Because I want to repeat, yes, the Pope is the Antichrist, but it's bigger. It's the little horn in Daniel. It's the son of perdition, the man of sin, and in Revelation 17:5, the mother of harlots. And just what you said, you see. So the reason why I view it like myself, if I am not going to take away anything from the Protestant Reformation. I mean, the Protestant Reformation was a light, and it didn't shine over the whole world.
I agree with you, but on the other hand, we also have to admit that
I'm not disagreeing with you.
No, but we have to see. We have to make this clear for our listeners here. You and I are not in a disagreement. No. But you have to see that all the reformers, whoever it was, they all were still partly mistaken. And one of the biggest points to prove that is when you go to the Council of Trent, where the Archbishop of Reggio, and I do not want to look that up right now. I can look that up, but you can look it up in the archives. We talked about that, and I made a video about it. It's almost 3 hours long. Nothing but the truth. Why didn't the reformers go all the way? There you will find the statement, me reading it, from the Archbishop of Reggio, who said at that time, "You Protestants claim to stand on sola scriptura, the Bible and the Bible alone, but still you accept and worship on the Sunday Sabbath, for there is no scriptural reference in the Bible to be found that Sunday is the Sabbath. So because you leave your ground that you stand on, saying sola scriptura, the Bible and the Bible alone, and there is no reference in the Bible that tells you to worship on Sunday, the first day of the week, instead of Saturday, the seventh day of the week, you are just rebels." And with that, the whole Council of Trent took another direction. Because before, a lot of the people, a lot of the bishops and everything who attended the Council of Trent were even prepared to throw their traditions overboard and to join the Protestants. But when the Archbishop of Reggio made clear that all the Protestants still worshipped on Sunday, where there is no reference in the Bible for but the tradition of the Roman Catholic Church, he destroyed at that moment the Protestant Reformation that was really going on during the Council of Trent. And this is a very sour aftertaste that I have of the Protestants. They didn't go all the way. They didn't go from the first commandment until the tenth commandment, because they left out the fourth commandment. And as I said earlier in this broadcast, as you might remember, the Sabbath is a sign of God. It is the mark of God. It is the mark of God's people to adhere to all the Ten Commandments, certainly to the fourth. And why is the fourth commandment so important? Because it is the mark of our Lord who made the world and everything that is in it, that he actually made it. And when you do not follow the Sabbath, the biblical Sabbath, you do not follow the teaching of God. But you follow the teaching of man. And let me tell you, there is no compromise possible. And there are quotes in the Bible over and over and over that state, what has light to do with darkness? How can the righteous walk with Belial? And all that stuff. There is no compromise. The word of God does not allow any compromise. That was the story of Israel in the Old Testament over and over and over again. Listen to my reading of Rulers of Evil, chapter 16, where I said that also. Where God over and over again pointed out to the Israelites, whether you follow me or you follow Baal. But you can't have it both ways. I do not compromise. And the Church of Rome is the same. She also does not compromise. It is whether her way or the highway. And to me, it is, from the Catholic point, the highway. I choose the Bible. I choose the truth. I choose to acknowledge all the Ten Commandments and to keep them as good as I can. I cannot keep all the Ten Commandments perfectly, certainly not the Sabbath commandment, but I can try to do my best. When I still sin, that is why I confess my sins to Jesus Christ. And in his grace, he will forgive my sins. Because you can try to be righteous. But as the Bible says, there is not one righteous. No, not one. You got something to finish here, Wolf? Otherwise, I do the reading now.
Well, the thing of it is, I just want to clarify that, you know, the Protestant Reformation, the Protestant Reformation, is bigger than the word just protesting Rome. It's the opposite of Rome. And it's a much, it curtails a much broader scope, you know, and I mean, because in the words of Wiley, see, when you read what he says, Protestantism is a principle which has its origin outside of human society. You see, when that light hit in the Dark Ages, in the Inquisition, I mean, Luther, when Luther first got a hold of the Bible, you know, I mean, all the reformers, and see, I believe in freedom of conscience. I believe in remember the Sabbath. I remember. But I remember what Christ has done. You know, and in other words, I'm not condemning the world because of the Sabbath. People have their right to freedom of conscience. Now, when people read the Bible, read God's Word, the more that I have researched and heard different debates, it's amazing how they want the simplicity of the gospel. And Henry Grattan Guinness says it better than I could ever say it. You know, and I think, again, what understanding, and my question, I answered it on my part. I answered my, what this has done for me, understanding the truth, the gospel, and how it's been distorted by Rome. You know, it's made me humble. I mean, I have to intersect this right now. You know, this happened to me about a year ago. Somebody wrote me an email and accused Tom Fress of preaching futurism. Well, and then here a week ago, I had it done to me again by another party saying, Walt, you know, you and York are teaching futurism. You say, well, now, where are you going with this, Walt? Well, it goes back to the Word of God, and it goes back to casuistry and sophistry. See, when somebody accuses York and I of preaching futurism, I listen. But see, casuistry is dishonest reasoning. First of all, it's just off the wall. I refuse. Because the next place they take you is they take you to sophistry. The art of influencing the thought and conduct of an audience by argumentation. That's where it goes. And see, my website, Grand Design Exposed, by the way, Grand Design is a Roman term. I mean, that's their term for their grand design. John Daniel wrote a book called The Grand Design Exposed, exposing the grand design. But Rome is the grand design. Malachi Martin used it in his book. You see, in casuistry is a system of rationalization to do legally what is forbidden morally. And I sometimes think, and that's the question I had, I was going to ask, but I know it's what it's done to me. It's made me more humble. And they want to draw you into an argument. See, and the only argument that I did is I quoted John 18:36. I said, "My kingdom is not of this world." This is Christ, the Messiah, speaking. "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence, from here." Okay. In other words, I refuse to debate, to enter into the debate. And then I said, "You're attacking me." He said, "No, I'm not." I said, "Yes, you are." I didn't lose it. He says, "I'm going to hang up." I said, "Well, if I believe in freedom of conscience, and if you feel that you have to hang up, you can hang up." And he did. And then he texts me and says, "I don't argue." So what is the solution? All of this discourse, you go up to Grand Design Exposed, and in this book, The Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy, or it could be called the Vatican Counter-Reformation Global Conspiracy. It could be called that too. It's pieces of the puzzle. Now, I've been attacked with this kind of, what do you call it, theology.
Dominion theology.
They want to attack you. They want to attack you because you don't. You see, I solely believe that I am really thankful that I've had my 70 years in America. Now, there's other places in the world that's had some peace and serenity here and there. But I am not anti-American. I'm very pro-Bible. And the greatness and the goodness of this country did not come from the Constitution of the United States and the Bill of Rights. It came from the Bible. I was living in a country that obeyed God's laws. You don't need man's laws. And I'll tell you what American really is. Americans became very independent. And it started, it didn't start in 1776. It started when they hit the boat and got off the boat in a land and winter's coming. That's where it started. They either, and a lot of them didn't make the first winter. And this country, and when the revolution started in 1776, there was 99% of independent Protestants. They really didn't need anybody. They didn't need Europe. They didn't need the Pope. I've flown across this United States in 1977 in my little Cessna 150. I had a bird's eye view of America. And then from 1991 to 2001, I drove back and forth across the United States. When you get up in the air over Indiana, over Illinois, and you're at about 2,000 feet or 1,000 feet, 3,000 feet, you can look in 360 degrees around you and you'll see nothing but farms. What built this country was the Bible, because they went to work. A man don't work, he don't eat. And they got it from the European worth ethics. I've in my life in 71, I'm a baby boomer, but I've had the opportunity to meet rural people. I've rode a couple roundups in Nevada with down-to-earth people that made their living with their hands. They didn't need a federal government. They didn't need Rome to tell them what to do. But that's why I am still a Protestant, because Protestantism is what built this country, not the government, because the people were Protestants. They knew their Bible. They knew Daniel. They knew 2 Thessalonians. They knew Revelation 17. And the only way the Jesuits could become a Jesuit enclave was to do it with the mind. So they went after the seminaries and the Bible colleges.
Yeah, that's a good point to turn on to the reading and part two of this chapter.
So I am a Protestant, and Protestantism is part of history. It's the light that God give us. Now, listen, man never – listen, there were no different than the Israelites. Look what happened to the Israelites. We've turned our back. You know – this last week, I just got to be really frank with you. You know, we're running out of time. We're just running out of time. I mean, the Pope's coming in 2 weeks. But what you see in the streets of America is Roman Catholicism. This country is solidly Roman. Not only government, but in the pulpit. Because there's no way that the Pope could ever come over here if he didn't take over the pulpits first. This is very important, and I have my freedom of conscience, and I accept my brother York's opinion and his freedom of conscience. I accept it. But he lives in Europe. I live in America. He didn't choose to live in where he's living, and I didn't choose to live where I'm living. But I'm going to say one thing about America. This country, the biggest problem with this country is they're spoiled. This country has afforded more freedoms. I met a young Basque man when I was driving truck. He was Basque. He came over here as a sheep herder. Did his term as a sheep herder, went to work and leased a truck and started buying a truck, and he paid for it. Bought and then he went back to Spain, but before he went to Spain, he owned a house. That's America. Now, I'm telling you, Rome has taken that off. And they're taking it away from us. They've took it away from us. And I hear all this uncertainty and FUD. I call it FUD, fear, uncertainty, and I forget the other one. But I'm going to tell you something. You know, look, just I'm not trying to run America down. But what York and I are trying to show is how we got in this state. Because they're not only doing this to America. They've already done it to Australia. They've taken their guns away. And Europe is the European Union, a Holy Roman Empire over there.
Absolutely.
And now there's a few out in the England has ruffled their feathers, and then you have Greek. They don't want it, you know. But the European Union was Hitler's dream. Don't forget, it is Rome who's behind this. The little horn of Daniel, the man of sin, the son of perdition, the mother of harlots, and a Jesuit to boot. And how did he do it? How did they do it? They did it through ignorance. And everybody's running around here blaming the Bible, blaming the government. It's not the government. They've forsaken their Bible. America has forsaken what's got them, what we got.
Because of entertainment and because of false education, which is not education but indoctrination, and they've taken the Bible out of the life of the people, of the daily life.
Not only in America, but in...
Only in America, all over the world, but especially in America, because America was, sadly to say, is not anymore, but was the last big Protestant country in the world that Rome had to conquer. They conquered England a time ago already. And that fear that could also happen in America led to 1776, which you will understand when you read Rulers of Evil, where this is very well laid out, and which you will even more understand when you follow Tom Press's reading of the Global Vatican that he does for the moment on Inquisition Update on First Amendment Radio. When you read that book, when you follow that book, the Global Vatican, you will absolutely understand. And also, when you go back to the citation that I did in the beginning of this broadcast from Signs of the Times and the quotations from, other, among others, Charles Chiniquy, you would see that it was the plan of the Roman Catholic Church all along to overthrow this country. And to overthrow it, they had to infiltrate it.
They had to take over the pulpit.
They had to take over the pulpit, and they had to take over the government. And one of the biggest signs that they took over the government, one of their biggest signatures to take over the government, was the signing of the Federal Reserve Act in 1913 that was granted to them by Woodrow Wilson, who later on in his life told the American people that he felt sorry about it because he sold his country out to the Roman Catholic Church. He didn't say it in that words, but you can look it up. Woodrow Wilson was a puppet of Pope Benedict XV. Before, in 1913, with the Federal Reserve Act, and during the First World War, between 1914 and 1918. And when you research Marshall Foch, who was the Supreme Allied Commander of the Allies of World War I, he stated in 1919, and you can look that up in Wikipedia, it's there, he said, this is not peace, this is an armistice for 20 years. And exactly 20 years later, in 1939, the Second World War broke out. So this was exactly not a peace. No, because in Versailles, the burden that was laid on Germany was so big that they knew that from there had to come another war within a generation. And it came in 1939. And I'd like to refer to the war from 1914 to 1945 as the Second 30-Year War, which was nothing else than Inquisition, right in your eyes. Inquisition against the Jews, Inquisition against Protestants in Germany and England, all over Europe, against the Serbs in Croatia at that time, with Pavelic, with the Ustashi. It was an Inquisition. It was a counter-reformation war, the same that the American War of Independence was. The war between 1770, help me a little, what is it, 1706 and 1783, if I get my dates right here.
Say that again.
The American War of Independence.
1776.
1783. That was a counter-reformation war. And the First and Second World War, the Second 30-Year War, was a counter-reformation war, as was the 30-Year War between 1618 and 1648, that killed over more than 12 million German Protestants at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And when you want to learn more of that, then you have to go to the archives, and there's a button on Grand Design Exposed that will lead you to that. Jesuits Derouting the Reformation, a broadcast Walt and I did almost 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, tomorrow we have our anniversary that we have known each other for 2 years, Walt.
9/11, yeah.
It's only 2 years, but to me it seems like a lifetime. It seems like I've all known you all the time.
Well, you know, sometimes when you look at the reality, when we look at what is really going down, it's testing, my faith. I mean, it's making me humble. It's realizing that I can't change anything. That I have to solely rest with Christ and turn it over to Christ. I mean, and it's so heavy. Like yesterday, for the first time, I heard the school buses running again. I live in a rural place. And when I realize, you know, that's where the attack was. You know, and the thing of it is, I have to be honest with the listeners and with you, York, and God knows. You know, I'm 71 years old and raised a Lutheran. I was raised by Lutheran only by name. I was raised Catholic. These evangelical churches are Roman Catholic. It's only by name that they have their different flavors.
And that's the point that I wanted to make when I read to you the explanation of Protestantism of Webster's Dictionary of the 1828 edition.
See, I'm concerned with the listeners. This is a pretty heavy message. And what do you do to counteract it? You take God's word and you rest totally. God will take care of you. And it might be rough. It might be rough for you, it might be rough for me. But we are in a period of a little bit of grace. You're not going to be able to talk like this. You know, I don't get into dates.
Well, if I'm not,
if
I'm not able to talk like this anymore, then life has no sense anymore, you know?
Well, no, it doesn't
stop
there.
If I have no freedom of conscience anymore?
Yeah, but
that's worth dying for.
Well, and that's what it might be.
Yeah, probably.
That's what it might be. I mean, that's why I'm looking at it now like this. You know, when I started researching and started putting the pieces together, you know, I mean, I had no idea where it was leading me. But, you know, the evidence is so overwhelming now. I've read enough books. And the book I got to read more of is the Bible. I've got enough books. I've got enough information. And I'm interested in the people that listen to this broadcast, because in other words, I remember doing broadcasts with Tom Fresh, and he did some magnificent broadcasts, and when it was all over, you could hear a pin drop. And the reason why is, see, once you know the truth, and God has revealed a little bit of this to us a little bit at a time, this isn't feel good one and two. But when Tom read Romanism and the Reformation, that book rocked my boat. I finally started realizing what a Protestant was. And then reading J.A. Wiley, in other words, the word Protestant is a big word. It's divine. It's divine knowledge, not from the Pope. Pope's going to come over here and speak on global warming. Ludicrous, absurd. And people are going to laud him and clap. Boy, when he walks into that chamber, they're going to give him a standing ovation. That's reality. And he's going to speak at Freedom Hall in Philadelphia using the same lantern or podium that Abraham Lincoln used when he spoke the Gettysburg Address. You don't think that there's a message in that? They have taken over America without even a whimper. How dead is the pulpit? It's as dead as futurism. Futurism is a denial of the gospel. It's an abomination. It's blasphemy. It's time to just call it for what it is. Let the chips fall where they may. Because I'm going out in the world after I hang up here into the world that knows nothing about what we talked about the last hour and a half. Not even a clue. Not even an inkling.
Well, that's why we're doing it, to get more people into the knowledge.
Well, that's true too. But the people, you see, you're not going to be. I'm interested in. I love the people that listen to this call are people that need fellowship. You're all right. When you start understanding the Bible and you understand Rome, how can you understand world affairs if you just take Romanism out of your vocabulary? Well, I can tell you, I was raised that way. I'm 71 years old, and it's not any different than today. Those kids, when they go by here on the school bus, we would be completely devastated if we looked into their school books and seen what was really being taught them.
Well, you know, Walt, we can wrap it up like saying like that. When you believe what Rome teaches, the world just doesn't make any sense. Sense comes into your life when you read the Bible.
That's
and
right.
Then you compare the word of God with the word of man, and then you will see what makes sense. And it is not the word of man that makes sense, that is taught from the pulpit and that is taught from the Roman Catholic Church. Listen, Wolf, we have already done a little bit more than 1.5 hours, and I want to wrap it up so that we don't have too long.
We have a very
full agenda for next week, doing the reading, which we postponed.
We'll just do that. We'll do the whole reading next week, but
the way the podcast went today, you know, it's just we're making it up as we go along, and I love the things that we talked about, and not only the signs of the times of the Catholic taking over of America and all the stuff that you said also. I really liked it, but I want to end it up here. So when I may ask you to some closing remarks.
Okay. Well, yeah, so we'll see you next week. God bless. I appreciate the listeners that do listen and share. I mean, this broadcast is kind of a one week where I can share my heart.
Yeah, once in a week we can share our heart and we can all let it out and share it with other people. And this is also why I am doing that, because, I'm not getting any richer by this. I only get richer in my heart by this.
Yes.
I love doing this, and I want to thank everybody who was in our chat room to join us in our broadcast, guest six, thank you very much for attending until the end. And all the others, thank you very much for watching the video that I will make later of this broadcast. And until next week, you can be sure we will be back then, as long as we are alive, God permitting, we will be here and do then continue the reading of the book, or the chapter of the book from Cold War Babylon, the Revolutionary War, how America became a Jesuit enclave, and we'll go more into that. So thank you for listening so far until today, and until next week, God bless you, and bye-bye.